40 seconds. T minus 30 seconds. T minus 20 seconds. Ten, nine, eight, seven, six, five, four, three, two, one, zero.
It's your Manchester. Please welcome Michelle Eagleton and Belinda Scandal.
Well, a very good evening and welcome to each and every one of you joining us for this week's episode of
Your Manchester.
How are we all? What a strange week it's been.
It's been quite
smooth. Oh, very well done. It's been blinking horrible, to be completely honest with you.
Yeah, I don't know.
I'm coming out now, don't you? I always know when I'm coming. But anyway, we have got a wonderful show lined up for you this evening, everybody. We really, really have. How's your week been, though?
Do you know what? Apart from the obvious, It's been all right. I think the
just seem to be blinking into each other.
I'm excited about stuff. You know, it's Halloween around the corner.
Yeah. So
I'm
getting in here. Yeah. And then I start to get here about Christmas music. Yeah. And when comes on, I'm like,
yes.
Yeah. And then I'm like, no. Mine's the only bonfire. Oh, I love the bonfire. A bit of treacle. I've got much nice bonfire. Fireworks display.
I bet you
can't do that. And if we do, the army will tell us off, everybody. At this point, we should say a big thank you to Mr. Byrne for all his continued efforts making Manchester attempt to tick along. And we'll find out more in a little while from our LGBT plus czar, Mr. Carl Austin Behan. He's going to be joining us in the studio. And as well as that, just to mix it up, we've got an athlete, everybody, called Marilyn Okoro. She's going to be joining us in the studio.
She's absolutely fantastic. She has been to the Olympics. She has represented CUGB. She's still doing her stuff, and she's also having some choices out as well.
We'll try and get Tom Daly at one point. Who doesn't want Tom Daly? Let's make it please.
He's knitting.
He's made. Crocheting.
Well, yeah. Well, same thing. Bigger holes. Oh,
he's
done crocheting.
Yeah. Same.
He's crocheted a pair of underpants. Like,
has he modelled them yet?
He has. I've seen it on his Instagram.
That's
oh,
cool.
Shame.
Right,
missed that one.
You know, if you're Manchester, I'm going to
have points. That's on Bailey's. Indeed. Now, joining us in the studio today, of course, we've got our lovely Victoria and also a lady all the way from the Greater Manchester Fringe. This is Zena Barry, everybody. And welcome to you both this evening. How are you?
Hello.
Good. How's life ticking along for you both?
It's ticking along.
I think that's the stage where everybody's got now. It's kind of just happening for everybody,
yeah,
isn't it?
Just gotta roll with the punches.
I did make the fatal error today, though, of thinking that it was 28 days and potentially a bit longer. Yeah.
Well, I thought
you
meant 28
days in one. February. No way.
That's actually. Halloween's on the
31st.
Yes, indeed. Modern roots.
It's your head looks lovely, but a little flick.
And well, I've been inspired by your
little your clothing plug.
But what's on socials? No. What have we got to talk about tonight? Are we going to be talking about what you think about us going into today on Friday? How do you feel about it? Is that what something you're going to be asking the question?
Yes, so we just want to hear people's thoughts, really. How are you feeling? What's going on? What do you think about tier three? What do you think about Andy Burnham? It's been quite a week for Manchester, really. So any thoughts? So I don't know how it's going to affect people, because I know
I'm not sure Vicky's mic's on, to be honest with you.
I am.
Not here,
yes, very,
but we'll
very
see. Do my best.
So it's extremely strange at the moment.
No, exactly.
it's not a great sign. But, you know, that kind of leads us into the uncertainty that places that clubs are going to be facing, and also the impact it's possibly going to have on the theatre. So we are really grateful to have seen it here on the Greater Manchester Fringe, because dying for this to go on.
Yeah.
We love it. It's one of the most amazing events in our city. There's a real buzz about it. We've had it delayed.
Mm.
We tried to change it to Garden Fringe.
Yeah.
And then
restrictions.
Yeah. And now, where are we at? Is it going to go ahead properly?
Well, at the moment, we've got to a point where I don't know. We've taken it. I grated my phone, so that's what I'm
doing. I thought it was your mask rolled up.
We're taking it day by day because it's just impossible to know, because they keep changing the rules so quickly. And have the theatre companies emailing me every day saying, do you know what's going to happen? Can we do it? And I don't actually know any more than you do. At the moment, you can do it, but who knows?
Well, how do you know about planning such a big event as the Greater Manchester Fringe? You don't know what's going on.
There's so many productions, which means there's so many different companies involved. It's not just like one touring company, is it?
No, I mean, normally during the summer, I have about 150 different companies taking part, which we were all lined to have this summer, but then to cancel all of that, and then lots of the companies, because we thought we'd be able to be up and running by now, because obviously none of us have been through this before.
Well, we got to a stage where it looks like everything was going the right way, didn't we?
Yeah.
And all of a sudden we've gone backwards again now.
Yeah. So it's a much smaller festival. We've had a few shows having to drop out because of cast members self-isolating. So we've just kind of taken it day by day. But there is actually a sold-out show on tonight.
Carlton.
So that's a lovely thing. And I know that, you know, because of social distancing, there's not many people can actually go to it. But I think they're going to have a really lovely time.
That's so, what's good about the theatre, or the entertainment that you particularly provide. It's not one genre. It's lots and lots of different things. And people go there as much as obviously you want to make some pennies from it, obviously.
Mm.
We're talking
about mental health at the moment and the effect that COVID is having on our mental health. You know, going and having a form of escapism at the theatre, you know, that is something that we all
do. Yeah, it really is. And when I tried to get the Garden Fringe up and running during the summer, we had one event in my garden, and I did the teching from on top of my washing machine and had the cables running out my back window, and the entertainment happened on my decking, and everybody turned up around the back gate with their little camp stools, and there was booze in the shed, and a camp toilet in different shed, and the cats were running about, and all the, you know, neighbours were hanging over the fence, and everyone, like, the comedy was great, but I think everybody was just like, ah, oh, we're doing the thing, and it just feels really great to be part of a shared experience. It's just like a real relief.
You have to think about the creators behind it as well, don't you? Because a lot of people would have already been rehearsing for these events.
Yeah.
And if they don't happen, with all their hard work, effort, time, goes straight out the window, doesn't it?
So name a few that we can see, because let's go on the positive.
Yes,
all
you're quite right,
Shel,
yes.
Full show at King's Arms. Sold out tonight, brilliant.
Yeah.
Name a few others that are still happening.
There's a show called Homeboy. It's like a sort of musical act. He used to be in Big Country years ago, one of the family members of Big Country. And he's doing a show about a book that he's written, and that's at Antoinette Mansion.
I've heard about that.
We had another show on there a couple of weeks ago, like a psychic medium show.
Was he real?
It's fly.
Let's say yes. Yeah. And that was great banter,
I'm getting it.
How's
that possible?
It's quite hard for him because it's a small audience. I think like a medium, if you've got like 100 people, you can say, this is a Gemini here, and somebody's going to go, yes.
Somebody's going to agree, so he's all right then, isn't he?
Yeah, the small group.
Yeah.
So this is a Gemini here, and you're
like, no.
No.
So is this a grand place when it goes to Antwerp Mansion?
It has been grand at some point, but it's now very much faded glory.
Yeah.
But it's
pretty incredible. Just so that's a great thing about Greater Fringe. It's like you can go to venues that you probably wouldn't associate would have performances on, and we can feel, you know, really kind of connected with the atmosphere.
Theatre, it's necessarily theatres.
Well,
we would, because we are waiting for all the theatres to reopen, please, and back.
Yeah, hey, please.
So if you go to the Greater Manchester Fringe.co.uk website, look at what's on, click on the day that you fancy on your night out and see what's on, and just try whatever you can find.
I know you got me at night out.
Yeah, and anyone who's still managing to perform at them, it would be so grateful for an audience like that, because it's just...
I know I will.
Yeah.
And also, just to kind of support anybody who's going to come in, probably a bit apprehensive about, you know, what's it going to be like, you have got all the safety measures in place.
Yeah. Oh, God. All the venues have really gone out the way. And massively reduced capacities. You've got special machines that you switch on and disinfect, so like sprays of room. And they've done so much work to make it right. Like, everything sounds like you can pick up the whole of the upstairs so that you can set away from people in your bubbles. So it is as safe as anywhere I can be at the moment.
And is planning already ahead for next year?
We didn't get any arts council from then. No.
Wow, that's a big one.
Yeah, that was I mean, last week I sort of had my head on the desk for most of the week. Just like, oh! So we didn't get
3 minutes left on this if you run into time. Carl's in, but we'll do whatever we need to.
So do you feel undersupported then by the government brass
and massively. Because yeah, we weren't eligible for furlough, and we weren't eligible for any grants because we work from home.
Yeah.
So we've had nothing.
Let's bring in Carl Austin Behan at this point then. Hello, Carl, how are you?
Hello.
Oh,
can you hear me?
It's a sad state of affairs, isn't it, when it's hearing something like that? And I know you must be hearing a lot of them, Carl.
No, because also I'm president of Contact Theatre, and we've seen the amount of sort of funding that's just sort of disappeared. The revenue, the sort of even the little cafes, all the things that sort of keep people together within the theatres, not just the actual, it's all the people behind the scenes as well that are sort of in the same predicament, and it's awful.
So this week then, Carl, has been a very strange week, and we can't obviously speak to Mr. Burnham at the moment, but I'm sure there's a lot of his thoughts that you share with him. How do you feel that Manchester has been treated in the past week?
I think it's been treated really badly, in the fact that if we've got to remember, and this isn't political at all, but if you remember, it was the Tory government that imposed us to have a mayor across Greater Manchester. If those of you remember, a few years ago, we actually had a vote, probably about 8 or 9 years ago, and we voted unanimously not to have a mayor so that the leaders themselves could make those decisions. However, it was the Tories that actually imposed a mayor on us. And now the mayor is standing up for everyone across Greater Manchester, putting that fight there. And, you know, he's been supported unitedly and unanimously by the other 10 leaders across all of Greater Manchester with the package that they worked out. So I just think we've been being polite. I think we've sort of been kicked right in it.
And Andy Byrne, of course, said canaries in the coal mine. Have we been?
Well, I think, you know, even when we listen to the news reports, when they come in from Westminster, when it comes from Sky, when it comes from any of the news channels, they talk about the city of Manchester, you know, they talk about areas within Greater Manchester. you don't even know the demographic. They don't know the area. They don't know the venues that we've got. They don't know the makeup of what Mancunians are and across the whole of Greater Manchester. And I do feel that part of the problem we've had with London is the fact that they've not liked the fact that Andy has had the support of all the leaders, because I think they probably wanted us to have sort of fell out and just sort of agreed to what, you know, they originally offered the 22 million. The leaders all came together 10 days ago and actually properly costed how much it would be for Greater Manchester to make sure that all the staff were properly covered. You know, the 67% of people's wages isn't acceptable. People can't survive on that. Especially in the sort of, especially for the bars and clubs and those sort of people, and they rely on tips as well, a lot of them. 67%, it's just not doable. It's not acceptable. And also, if the venues are closed, then where's the top going to come from? Because the venues can't pay the extra. The venues are going to struggle themselves to pay the rent and pay what they need to pay in the first places. They've still got to pay all the bills. Yes, they keep giving them sort of loans they can take, but why would you want to take a loan out at the moment, not actually knowing whether or not you've got a business in 6 months to come back to?
I know, and you know, the thing is, I also don't think that Boris was ready for Andy, and a lot of the media weren't ready for Andy, because lots of interviews that I saw him do, he had the answers for every question. He knew, he researched it, had that passion. And I don't think that we see that enough. And it's been great to see him show that and know that there's somebody out there who is standing up for us Mancunians. I know, you know, it might not have worked out of him, but he did give it a damn good fight. And now what I don't want to happen
is
Andy to get, you know, raped over the coals. Because as we know, there's a lot of trolls out there.
Yeah.
Who will be kind of
sticking
their oar in, but, you know, I'm sure you don't want that either.
No, you broke up a bit then, but I think I've got the gist of it. And I know they've turned around and said, you know, the 60 million is still on the table, and we'll talk to the council leaders. I'm just hoping that all those same council leaders that have supported Andy and backed him up with what he said, all do come together and get the package that they want. You know, the original, it was costed out to £90 million up to the end of the financial year. I think we've worked it out that it was going to be £15 million per month up until the end of March. And that was
Lee is lined up for next.
And then I think they managed to sort of say, okay, we can accept 75. But then they even managed to go lower to 65, and that was the lowest they could possibly go. That was to take into account anything that they got and the support. And if you think about it, so we've got 10 boroughs in Greater Manchester, and then 60 million, you know, when they offered the 22, and then they offered the 60,
it's got excess, you know, speed issue,
million per sort of borough. And that, you know, that's a big borough, but then obviously Manchester itself with the demographic and the amount of bars and the amount of culture and the amount of homelessness and everything else that we've got in there, it just isn't enough.
No, I know. Do you know what? I still think, in some respects, and I know this might be kind of a bit of a cliche, but I think that they all think in London that we wear flat caps and have cobble streets. Yeah. And I don't even think they know how many boroughs that we've got. Yeah, I think you hit the nail on the head there. I didn't think it's just great expansion. It's just one thing. I don't realise that it spans so vastly.
The MPs and the councillors, can they change what's happened? Can they make a difference now? Or is it, that's it, it's been dealt with?
Well, no, I think there's still a lot of talks that will take place and are taking place. And obviously, I know that there's a thing about six MPs that had a go at Andy, but they, you know, surprisingly, were the six Tories that we've got across Greater Manchester. Because they're obviously their government. But it shouldn't be about politics. This is about
people. The previous stuff come out, by the way.
It's all about, you know, making sure that everyone is supported. You know, bars can't remain open. You know, having to close on Friday, well, Thursday night, they don't know when they're going to open. I know that they said that, you know, this is the energy of the days and the review, but we don't know what's going to happen after that. And the days might turn into 28 weeks for all we know.
I know. I mean,
and how do people survive then on this?
You know, I know that if you go on the gov.uk website, there's been information that's come out on there today. Unfortunately, I've been on Zoom since 3 o'clock, so I've not managed to catch up with some of that stuff. But there is, if you want, I can send you the links over so that you can share them with the audience, and also talk about it in more detail at a later date. But there are grants, and there is the funding is there, and you know, it's like when people are being told to self-isolate. You know, I've got my own cleaning company, as you know, anyway. And yet, if we ask staff to self-isolate, it makes it really awkward, not for them as well, but also for us to find the staff to sort of fill that place. But also, then they're not, you know, they're on the SSP. The government initially paid all this, but now, and it's quite strange that now London's just going into tier two, they're now talking more about financial packages. Again, that's only now that London's involved rather than, you know, being part of the Northwest, being part of this whole North South divide. And unfortunately, I think we're going to see the North Side divide get wider and wider if this continues.
Okay. Well, Carl, if you don't mind staying with us for a few more minutes, we are now going to try and cheer ourselves up just a little tad by checking in with our Haylet and seeing exactly what's going on the mark!
Hi, I'm Hayley, and welcome to this week's On The Box. How is everybody doing? What have you been watching? As usual, drop me a tweet at HeyKate, HayKate. Drop me a tweet and let me know what you've been watching and what you think of things, really. Let me know what you think about different programmes. Give me your critique. Now, I want to chat a little bit about what's coming up in October. I touched on it the other week and I want to finish it off this week because I cannot wait for Rebecca. It is a Netflix adaptation of the outstanding novel and it stars Lily James of Downton Abbey fame. Now, if you haven't seen BBC One's Life, do watch it. You can catch all the episodes on iPlayer. Now, it was written by Mike Bartlett of the Dr. Foster fame, and it stars Alison Steadman and Peter Davison, and also Victoria Hamilton, Adrian Lester, Rachel Sterling, Sarah Chowdhury, and Melissa Johns. ITV has Singapore Grip. I think all of those episodes are now available on ITV Player, so do catch up. There's also series 2 of Ghosts on BBC, so do have a look at that. Now, Kath Tildesley of Corrie fame, she wrote a play called Ceremony while she was in lockdown, while we were all in lockdown. And she has since cast some well-known faces, including Sue Johnson and also Paula Lane. Now, a producer has snapped it up, so I will let you know more about that as we progress. Now, that's it from me. I think next time I will talk about, well, I will give you my choices for all things spooky for the run up to Halloween. I'll catch you next time. Bye.
Do you know what? She's a good man.
I always think my music's been going to count down.
Yeah.
Yeah. We've got so many comments coming in, everybody. We know we're having a slight sound issue at the moment, but we haven't explained that.
It's all right,
you
can still hear me.
Can they not hear me? Is that the issue?
You can hear both.
We've blocked you out.
Hey!
We've got her on mute. It's all right, but I wanted to say before we go to our next BT with the lovely and fabulous.
Yeah.
I don't know what she's
talking
about. I want to say a farewell to our lovely team because I know you've got lots to do right now. Mm-hmm. You've got to look after your poorly thumb, your cheese growing thumb.
Is that literally done with grating cheese?
That's
all right. I can get an injury if it's cheese. That's fine. I'll live from the cheese.
I don't put it though.
I eat it by the slap. Like that.
But good luck for the rest of Greater Manchester Fringe. If you can get there, folks, please do. Go support it.
Yeah.
Absolutely. And we will see you next year because we want.
And if worse comes to worse, you can always have a little drink, can't you? As our Charlie explains, right now.
Hello, my loves. It's Charlie Houston Sykes with this week's Booze and Bites. Now, the theme for this week is theatre and theatrical cocktails. And given the events of the last few days, it kind of feels a little bit apt. When I started researching this one, I fell down a massive rabbit hole. I mean, you may think of it as being a relatively new thing, cocktails named in the 50s, 60s, 70s, after stars and musicals and theatre productions, and more recently known as going into Oscars, drinking a gin goblet named after a musical and belting out Let It Go at the top of our voices. But that's actually not the case. I have found cocktails dating back to the 1880s and 1890s, predominantly around Broadway, but I wouldn't be surprised to find that there were drinks, if not cocktails, from the Drury Lane era. And some of them you'd actually probably recognise. So, for example, we have the Rob Roy, kind of a Scotch twist on a Manhattan. And that was named after the Rob Roy musical and created in the Astoria Hotel in New York. But it doesn't stop there. We also have a little convoluted one here for you, the Black Russian. So the Black Russian was created in honour of the US ambassador to Luxembourg, a lady named Pearl Mester. Now, Pearl was known as the hostess with the mostess, and it was her who was the inspiration behind Call Me Madam by Irving Berlin. See? Convoluted, but we get there. Perhaps one of my favourite facts is that the champagne cocktail, that really straightforward cocktail with bitters, sugar, lemon and champagne, was actually known as Chorus Girl's Milk. Another favourite is the Zsa Zsa cocktail. Now, Zsa Zsa was a play that was originally started in France, and it was about the illicit affair of a chorus girl with a married man, and it dates back to about, again, the 19th century, so about 1890-ish. The cocktail was created and bitters were a key ingredient because the American audience were really bitter that the more illicit elements had been skipped in their version. So basically, they were bitter because theirs had been censored. But of course, there are loads more modern versions. So for example, you have the Dirty Shirley. Take a Shirley Temple cocktail, add vodka, add cranberry, and that's in honour of Chicago. You have a twist on the Moscow Mule for Anastasia. So instead of putting ordinary vodka in, you put a citrus vodka in, which gives it a little bit more zest. But I've not finished. There are burgers named after musicals. There are milkshakes named after musicals. In fact, there's one bar in London that has six different milkshakes named after the six wives in Six. Perhaps my favourite of the non-alcoholic drinks is one named the Teacher's Pet, which is dedicated to the School of Rock. It's a blend of ginger ale, pineapple and cranberry. So it's just got a little tartness to it, and it's a really fruity little number. If you love your musicals, if you love your theatre, there is a drink out there, there is a meal out there for you. You'll just have to let me know which ones are your favourites.
That's fine, okay.
Well, there you go, everybody. You were having a proper chat. We're all.
I really thought that having a programme like this morning, I was really now I've become part of that family.
I know, well then.
In fact, actually, this morning when I was watching Good Morning Britain, Randy,
I love the way you can cross your legs, you know. I can't do that. I try, but I can't do
that. Like Kenny Everett.
Randy, who I've been watching on Sunday,
Oh, yeah.
She was talking with Kenny Everett, and that she feel like I was just there. So we're just normal people discussing something about socially, saying what is going on.
Let's bring up this comment first of all, please, because this is quite interesting. I'd be interested to know what Carl thinks about this. This is comes from our Jacko Eduardo, and he says the Chinese stopped COVID in its tracks with total lockdown in denser populated areas. Let's get it organized and over with. Carl, what's your thoughts on that?
Oh,
I know you're there, Carl.
He's added, I think he's frozen.
Oh, he's coming through. He's frozen. I'll try and get him back and get his thoughts on that and see what he makes of it. But
socially in general, you know, we've had a few comments like that, and we have
He's come back in now. I've got him back in.
Technical issues, but that was my fault.
Got him back on the separate stream.
I've got a clear piece in my ear, everybody, so it can make everything wonderful for you. I've also got a hanging earpiece behind the back just in case that one goes. That one wasn't good.
Is it wrong?
Carl's back in if you need him.
There is, right? There's a pub that's on the way to, what's it called? Holland Lake. And it's called the Gallows. And every time we pass it, it's family joke. We'll be going, oh, that pub's hanging.
Oh, because it's the gallows. Right, let's bring that comment back up. Did you see that comment, Carl?
I didn't know, unfortunately.
Let's bring that up for you then.
Let me find it.
Okay,
there you go.
So this was from one of our viewers.
Yeah. So it says, the Chinese stopped COVID in its tracks and total lockdown in dense populated areas. Let's get it organised and over with across the country. Thoughts?
I think we need to have I think we should have a complete total lockdown for about a month. I know Wales are going to do it for, is it 2 weeks? I think that if they're going to do it and other people start to do the total lockdown, we need to do it to support each other. Because all that's going to happen, I think, in 2 or 3 weeks' time, people are going to start going back into Wales and it's going to start again. So the only way we can do it is do a complete lockdown, in my opinion. And it would make, and again, make it very fair, make it so that people are getting the right financial support. But also we need to not just think about financial support, we need to think about the health and well-being. I know that there's the whole thing about, at the moment, even in tier three with the gyms, people need them. People need to be able to sort of be able to exercise. We were very lucky in the early stages with the first lot when we had the nice weather. You know, everyone started cycling, everyone was going for walks. You just look out the window now. There's no chance you can do that after 4 o'clock in the afternoon if it's not, you know.
What about running? Are we allowed to do running?
You can go running as long as you do it on your own. You can't do it in more than groups of six people.
Wow. An awful lot about running and athletes and athletic stuff. Is that
nice
the word?
Little segue. I think we're talking about me then.
You do. We know you.
I do
marathons.
I'm nowhere near in the same league as our next guest, am I?
No. So this is a lovely lady called Marilyn Okoro. Hello, how are you? Welcome to the show.
Hi, how are you? I'm very well. Thank you for having me. I wish I was actually there, though.
Yeah.
Do you know what? I am so in awe of you. I've kind of had a look at, you know, the backgrounds and all the stuff that you've done. You've been to the British World Championships. You've got a bronze medal. It's like, I bow down to you. How did you get started in this, Marilyn?
Very naturally, just probably like everyone else, everyone can relate to track and field. That's what I love about athletics. So for me, very natural introduction through school. I grew up in Northwest London originally behind Wembley Stadium, but I wasn't much of a footballer. Running was the most accessible. It was the cheapest thing to do. So yeah, I just love running, had lots of energy, naturally athletic. I did love tennis. Serena Williams is one of my idols. I did a lot of sports when I was younger, but it was just athletics that stole my heart, really.
And how important do you think sport is now, right at this moment?
It's massively important. I heard, you know, you guys just talking about running and lockdown, and I really resonated with, you know, when lockdown started, it was brighter, the sun was out, you're more motivated to get out there. Even myself now, some of my sessions are like 6-7 in the morning, and it's just so dark and rainy, and I am in the north. I'm getting used to this northern weather. It's very different, but it's really hard. But it is important just to get moving, whatever, you know, your activity of choice, just to get those endorphins flowing again. And, you know, movement, motion is lotion, I always say. It's good for you physically, but also it's so good for you mentally as well.
Oh, I like that very much.
I think you're going to pinch that phrase. Now, you said you're in the north. You're actually in Wigan now. Mm-hmm. Fantastic. Somebody likes Wigan here. Well, you know, as Alan mentioned when I introduced you, your career has taken you everywhere. I want to know what it's like being part of Team GB and then going to place like the Beijing Olympics. Wow.
Literally, wow. You know, when I started at 10 years old, the Olympics was far from what I had aimed for. I was having fun. I'm super competitive. I love to win. So it's been a phenomenal journey. But, you know, with every, you know, incredible sort of adrenaline rush thing that you do or chasing success, there's going to be those lows as well. But, you know, I've met some incredible people. I think that's one of the most powerful things about being an athlete and being part of Team GB. Because for the most part, you train in your silos, in your little training groups. But then when you make the national team, like, wow, that's like a dream come true. And then to make an Olympics, and I've been fortunate enough to go to every championship there is going. And I'm just going to look back. I'm nearing retirement now, but I'm going to look back with such incredible memories. It's been such an honour and something to really be proud of, which in the moment, a lot of athletes, you're just chasing that personal best. You're chasing those medals. But actually, when you stop and look back, it's been an incredible journey. And I'm so, so honoured and proud.
And what does an athlete do when they reach retirement? Because it's such an early age to retire, isn't it?
Yeah, so it's a really, really difficult subject, transitioning. I think you're transitioning all the time in life, and as athletes, you're transitioning all the time through your career. And something that's not really talked about a lot is transitioning out of your sport. It's essentially a bit of a death. It's essentially an identity crisis. So I'm really passionate about athlete welfare and trying to do a lot of work around that now. I've teamed up with some great friends of mine, Mandy Ayres and Charlotte, and we're working on Brand New Sport. And it's about inviting athletes to sort of think about that transition a little bit earlier than we tend to, and seeing yourself, because, you know, so many of us wear lots of hats. You know, I'm a motivational speaker, I'm a PT, I'm a support worker. So there's so many different areas that are, you know, that our skills will transfer to. But it's really difficult.
You're a singer as well, aren't you?
Yeah, oh, that was my uni band. So yeah, I'm a jazz and gospel singer, and just started by chance. My best friend Ben was like, well, do you mind, you know, filling in for a small gig? And it turned out to be the uni ball. But I went to the University of Bath, and we literally had such a blast. And it's the other part of me. It's something that I annoy everyone in the call room before we're about to go out to race, and everyone's nervous. I'm there singing away, but that's what calms me down, that's what centers me, that's what motivates me. So yeah, I love a good sing song.
Fantastic. And I think what you're moving into is a great initiative, because, you know, there is a stereotype that people, when they're watching athletes and they're seeing them compete, thinking, and you're seeing the big ones, you're seeing Mo Farah, and, you know, and you're going, oh, they must have lots of money, and, you know, and it must be such a, you know, a great sport to get into. But it's hard. It not only is it a hard graft, but it does rely on sponsorship, doesn't it?
Yeah, it's so difficult, you know, to. I think everyone just thinks they see medals. You know, I myself am an Olympic bronze medalist, but I still am working check to month trying to pay my rent, because it is so temporary. You know, it would be amazing if we were all Mo Farahs, Jess Ennis's, but, you know, that is, you know, the one percenters, and a lot of us are working alongside grafting every day. And it's a little bit ludicrous, because you're training so hard for something that comes every 4 years, and it's still not really guaranteed that you'll make the team or you'll even get there. But we're so passionate and we're driven by that. But at the same time, it's important that people get behind us, and sponsorship is so, so hard to come by. And in a year like 2020, even more so, you know, we've seen so many campaigns go up for people that have had their plans completely cancelled, and they've had to go into like jobs, you know, like Amazon drivers, or, you know, myself, I've been working for the incredible Brick charity, and just all, you know, doing our best to keep going, really.
I think, you know, we quite forget about how COVID is affecting athletes, you know, and the amount of athletes out there who have been doing that intense training, and then that kind of stops and their world goes upside down. What kind of things are you going to be doing then as part of this with, you know, those people that you mentioned?
My job now?
Yes.
Okay, so basically just looking at, I'd say mindset is a lot, you know, about it, just from looking at your identity. But there's really practical things. I personally am passionate about setting up a crisis fund for athletes, because this year, obviously, most of us make our money from traveling to races. A lot of them were cancelled, whether that's domestic or abroad. You know, obviously, the world has shut down a bit, so there will be no camps. But essentially, to get ready for championships, you do need that warm weather. You do need that, you know, that period of 2-3 weeks where you can just focus. So just raising money for athletes to be able to say, hey, you know what, I've had my earnings cut. Can I get some support in this way? So that's what I'm immediately working on. But Brand New Sport is really a series of resources that helps athlete network in the arenas that they might want to go into, you know, practical things like setting up a CV, introducing them to mentors and the industry that they might want to go into next. So just preparing us for life after sport.
Carl, just to bring you back in on this, Carl, are athletes supportive at all throughout this lockdown time now within Manchester?
I think it's the same as anyone within sports, and I think that they've had to sort of try and do training differently. I'm just grateful that the gyms did open when they did and be able to use that. But I think with all athletes and all sports, I mean, I don't understand, you know, when you're seeing like the footballers and they're sort of managing to do it, and then there's some sports that can do it, some sports that can't, you know. People still need to sort of be developing and still doing the sports and activities. There isn't a sort of pattern that sort of seems to be coherent. If you're working, you can have people all together. You can go on a bus, you can go on the trams. But then again, when you're out in sports, a lot of things have been stopped. And I just think it's a shame. And I think, you know, picking up on what was just said then, with mental health, it is a necessity to be able to do health and wellbeing and to do sports.
Well, last question that I want to ask you, Marilyn. Can we look forward to seeing you do another Olympics? Are you going to do one last Olympics for us?
That is definitely the goal. It's literally, you know, mind over matter now. I'm 36, but my body's still willing. So now it's just keeping strong mentally. So I'm sure with you guys behind me, I'll do my all to get out there. So that is the plan. Tokyo 2020 plus one. So, yeah.
Well, you can go, Marilyn. Please look at them nails.
This is... Gotta have the nails, dude.
I love that.
I need something to brighten up the days, you know.
It's certainly brightened up ours. Yeah. Marilyn, thanks so much for your time today.
Thank you. It's been lovely talking to you. Thanks so much.
Right, I'll tell you what we should do. We should do a bit of shopping now.
Oh, we should do a bit of shopping.
Now, do you remember when we went to John Lewis?
What, when I got this outfit?
And this one.
Yes,
which actually is quite a nice fit on the inside. Actually, I'm looking at it now.
You're in velvet tonight. I am in plush French connection. All saints.
And they're real leather, aren't they?
Absolutely.
They're comfy.
Look, I could cuff my
clothes.
All right. As you can see, I can't because I'm showing something that I get told off.
Big thanks to Emma from John Lewis. What would you do in lesson?
Yes, let's have a look when we popped in to ladies' wear as we go inside John Lewis.
I am really excited to be here. It's great to be back.
No, it's so good to be back. We couldn't wait to be back either. So we are back doing appointments like we used to be. Only difference is this time we're doing it for an hour, whereas it used to be 2 hours.
Still an hour though, isn't it?
Still an hour and it's free. Still all the same services though, so you know, you can come in for your workwear, you can come in for your perfect pair of jeans, just a wardrobe update if you want to, or special occasion if you've got one.
Now, I'm seeing this behind you, and I'm really intrigued. It says Style with Purpose. Is this new?
Yes. Have you heard of anyone called Erica Davey?
I do. She's the one from Instagram, isn't she?
Yes. Right, yes. Yeah. So she was a fashion editor for 20 years. Then in 2009, she decided to write a blog, and now she's got her Instagram account, where that's like her main job now. So she's done a collaboration with John Lewis with all these pieces. They're all handpicked by her. And 15% of the sales of these pieces goes to Refuge Charity.
Fab.
Yeah, so you're buying something nice for yourself and it's going to a good cause as well.
Gosh, and I suppose Style with a Purpose, it means that you can pretty much wear these clothes everywhere and feel comfortable. Yeah. I'm going to put you on the spot though, Emma. I really am. I'm going to say to you, what is the best thing that we should be buying this season?
Ooh, I would say, choosing from this collection that we've got here, this Reese lounge suit. So you know, we're all spending a lot more time at home, so you need to be comfortable, and then you can break this off and wear it separately as well. You know, you can just put a little slogan tee with the trousers, or you could pop that on with your skinny jeans and a pair of boots for going out somewhere.
I'm sold, Emma. And coming to you, India, you've been really busy recently. You've been doing some new things. Is it virtual appointments online?
Yeah, so we're running two different types of appointments, pretty much like home design. So one is a wardrobe declutter, so they can like pull out pieces pieces that they just don't really know what to wear anymore, or they're not like in love with, and I can find pieces on the shop floor for them to put with that, or new pieces that will just bring the wardrobe back to life again and make them fall in love with it. And then the other service is just like pretty much what we do in store with wardrobe refresh, so they can tell me what they're after, and then I'll pull the pieces together and talk them through it, and then at the end I send them an email with all the pieces on for them to buy, and then you can go online and buy it. So
I love that. I would love to do that, because you get to go and look at people's wardrobes. I'm so nosy.
You are nosy. Now listen, I'm just going to pop to menswear, all right?
All right, but why are you going to menswear?
It's a long story, Shel. It's a long story.
Has the response been really positive?
Really good, yeah. It's something different for them. And to go do it from home as well, it's nice for them to actually see what they've got, so they're not just thinking when they're in store, like, oh, what will that go with? I can actually see in the wardrobe and see what it's going to go with. So, yeah, it's great.
Brilliant. Yeah. I better go and check out where Bella's gone. You never know what she's up to.
Okay.
John Lewis there, everybody.
You know what, I absolutely adore their service, and the fact that that service is free, you know, it's saved me so many times, because lots of things I would never ever dream of picking up, I have now. They got me to wear long skirts. I'm 5'1" and you just kind of think, I'm not going to do a long skirt, what I do. And as well, this jacket, I'm going to sample that.
Go on.
Right, I've got jackets at home, which are black, and they cut off there, and I always thought that was right for me. But actually liking the oversized jacket.
Oh, it's nice.
You know what I mean? And I would never ever think that as a 5'1" person.
Are you a 5'1"?
I've got my heels on, so that's why my heels are a little bigger. Well, I love what
they've
got you.
It's nice. I like it. I like it very, very much. It's actually a good shape for me. I just keep catching myself and thinking it's quite... It's for a bit of a lady, it's a great shape.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, one of the days when I think a personal stylist are only good for people.
They are there to help you get the right thing. So, and then you give good ideas, and those good ideas get passed on to my friends as well, because they'll see something I'm wearing, and go, actually, I'm actually going to do it like that, and it gives back, keeps giving, and there's more from John Lewis. Oh, we're in menswear next week, God knows why, but we're in menswear next week. I'm going to check in the briefs, so, Carl, here, do you want Carl? Yeah, I did, yeah.
Yeah, and we all know about Tom Bailey's from before. I'm going to be checing that, I should check that out, well, I'll be a team, I'm just going to bring Carl in quickly and say to Carl, Carl, I just want to say something about the fashion at the moment, and obviously with all lockdown and everything sort of being the way it is, I, you know, I've not worn a suit at all since March, or a shirt, and you know, and it's just bizarre, you know, it's just like, you know, you're just going through the same sort of motions, not bought anything. So we're going to have a really strange sort of period of fashion in a few years' time when, you know, we've missed this year out.
Absolutely. Do you know what? There is a shortage of jogger twin sets at the minute, Carl.
Jogging trousers. We've seen that from the calendars of yesteryear.
Oh, we love having you on. Thank you for your wise words this evening and, you know, just coming on and being that voice for us.
Carl, just before you go, sum up, perhaps give a little bit of inspiration to the people of Greater Manchester just before you go.
Look, let's just be there for each other, support each other through this. You know, for the LGBT plus community, you know, we know that with Manchester's Gay Village, we're gonna see majority of that shut. But support where you can, support the places where you can do takeaways and takeouts, support the businesses throughout with anything that they're doing, if they're doing things online, you know, if they're doing a charity, we've seen a massive impact on charities. Support them the best you can, and we are going to come out of this, and we will come out stronger, and we will come out better. And yeah, I just want to say, you know, keep up the good work that everyone is doing. Stay safe, follow the guidelines. It's the only way we're going to get through this. And try your best not to let yourself go and break some of those habits, but just support each other and think about and ask people how they are. And do you know what? And if you ask how you are, be honest. If you're feeling like crap, tell people you're feeling like crap. Don't just go, yeah, I'm fine, because we're not. All of us go through stages where we have depression, we have anxiety, we have things in our mental health that we don't know that people are going through. Never assume that everyone's okay. So a real big push just to make sure that people are okay out there. My name's Carl Austin-Bean. My pronouns are he, him, and his. as today is International Pronoun Day.
Lovely. Thank you, Carl. Thank you very much.
Oh, do you know what? That really, really...
Michelle, I'm not okay. I'm really not okay.
Do you want the weather?
I need something good to go on, like, you know, perhaps some nice weather or something.
Well, we would have the weather, but, you know, it's...
Is it a birthday?
It's a very special birthday. Do you think he'll be in a weather for us?
He's probably in a pond or a field or something.
I know he is celebrating somewhere, and we are raising one hell of a big glass to you, our weatherman, Paul Rudd. This is to you. Happy blooming birthday. You are an absolute legend. Should we see what he's got to say about his weather?
I hope it's cheerful after all that.
Good evening, Shel and Bell, and welcome everyone to this week's weather forecast. And I'm Paul Rudd, and I'm back in my garden today, and it's my birthday. And let's have a look at this week's weather outlook. It's not looking too great, to be honest, I have to say. So Thursday is sunny and cloudy and rain with the temperatures of 11. Friday is going to rain with the temperatures of 11. Saturday is going to rain with the temperatures of 14. And Sunday is going to rain with the temperatures of 11. Now, I know, Shel, you don't like rain, but I'm trying to bring you a little bit of colour in what I'm wearing today, so I hope you like it. All right, that's it from me. Do join me again next week, and it's back to the lovely and fabulous Shel and Bell for this week's episode of Your Manchester.
Happy
birthday!
Happy birthday! Happy
birthday!
I think
that means party poppers as well, so they're off now.
And let them off! There you go.
I hope he saved us some
cake. We're going to get him in 1 week, aren't we?
Totally.
Yeah. I don't know why you're saying that. No. We're going to be bringing him in. Oh, everybody. And we're going to get him to do the weather. We're going to get him a green screen and everything.
Oh, brilliant.
I'm sure he'd good like that one. Is this camouflage?
I'll let him in if he does say that it's going to sunshine at some point.
I started off well, didn't it? And then rain. Rain, we will rise like a phoenix, everybody.
There we go.
Now, over the last few weeks, we have been doing...
Oh, I went too soon.
What?
Did you go too soon?
It's not a problem I have. Now, we are going to bring on our music video now. This is by a brilliant artist. We are bringing some artists over the next few weeks because you can't see them anywhere else, quite frankly. So we're bringing this one to you now. This is an artist called Xander, and this is Rise Like a Phoenix.
Walking over glass, neighbors say we're trouble. Well, that time has passed. Peering from the mirror, no, that isn't me. A stranger getting nearer, who can this person be? You wouldn't know me at all today. From the fading light I fly, rise like a phoenix, out of the ashes seeking rather than vengeance. Retribution you will want, once I'm transformed, once I'm reborn, you know I will rise like a phoenix, but you're my flame. about your business. Act as if you're free. No one could have witnessed what you did to me. 'Cause you wouldn't know me today. And you have got to see to believe. From the fading lights of life, rise like a phoenix out of the ashes, seeking rather than vengeance. Retribution you will want once I'm transformed. Threw me down, but I'm gonna fly and rise like a phoenix out of the ashes, seeking rather than vengeance. Retribution you will want what I transformed.
And that should be the anthem for what we're all experiencing, though.
I love that song for a start. That video was really dramatic. And his voice, Xander, I've got to say, that's the first time I have heard that artist sing. It was
very powerful.
Brilliant.
Very powerful.
Absolutely. I hope you all enjoyed that at home. If you do, you know, need to tell our social link.
Oh, yes! What's everybody been saying, please?
So, Anthony has said that Manchester's been treated appallingly by the government. So there's a lot of ranks, so that's the red flag for it. Mm-hmm. And then lots of happy birthdays to Paul.
Oh,
lots of happy birthdays.
It's what we like, isn't it? Yeah. He's a very special person, mm-hmm. He is. I just thought Manchester does take on Carlos influence there. We'll get through this.
Do you know what? That it was really quite emotional, I think. I mean, it made me feel emotional what Carl said. And again, it just shows how all of us in our community, we are really passionate. And I do think we will get through it. Because we are made of students, and it's shown by our encouragement, how we can tackle things. But these are
terrible times
that we shouldn't have to deal with. But as many humans, I know our hearts and our passion.
Nice words, lovely, very nice. Next week's show, everybody, we've got Chrissy Rock.
Yeah, hey.
Chrissy Rock on the show.
You never told me we had Chrissy Rock.
The Chrissy Rock on the show.
Excited.
All the way from North Wales, I do believe. North Wales is where she's from.
You never tell me
anything. I don't. There's a lot of surprise in your face. It's wonderful. Well, surprise me. Okay. Right, everybody. Thanks very much to all our guests. Do you know what's even more of a shock? I'm pregnant.
I've often
suspected
if he's watching at home and
if I'm going to watch. Oh, absolutely fantastic. Thank you very much. Thank you very much. Thank you very much. Thank you very much. Anyway.
If you like what we saw,
yes.
Then, you know, do me a lovely comment. And don't forget to subscribe, because we couldn't do this without you.
We couldn't indeed. So thanks very much to each and every one of you for watching this week's episode of
Your Manchester.